Commission wants to support new actions to create, to build the audience, a new kind of audience, in order for culture to reach all the audience and also the socially disadvantaged people. And I think actually there is really a need to create a kind of European cultural audience. Well, at the moment we have more like national cultural audience, not really a European cultural audience, which is simply, at the very beginning. And also the Commission wants also to support new actions to experiment new business models in the digital world. So while we have, again, the culture and the media program, of course the Commission wants to point much more on innovation and on innovative actions in order to really exploit the innovative potential coming from the sector and supporting with new financial instruments this potential. The European Creative Industry Alliance, I wanted to mention this, I don't know whether you're familiar, but this is a new platform which has been set up, not by, well, by the European Commission, but by a specific department. It's not the cultural department, but it's an enterprise department. And this is very much new, because for the first time, it is a different department who is taking care, who is getting interested in the sector. They created up an overall platform with like a core group who would make policy recommendations based on a series of pilot actions focused in three different topics. One is access to finance, another one is spillover effects, so it's what I was talking about before. Another one is about clustering and cluster cooperation. On this basis, some policy recommendations will be produced and then made available at European level. And again, actually, the people basically involved, the organizations involved in this platform are cities and regions. So again, the focus is on how cities and regions can make the most of this sector. So it's this is ongoing, and actually there is another project we're starting, and it's about creative clusters in Europe, and it's again led by BDG Enterprise. But this is actually only part of the story, because right now the European Commission is negotiating so the new programs, the new funding, and for instance another interesting program for the sector could be the Horizon 2020 program, which is the follow up with the research program, the FP7 program of the European Commission. This is much more focused on research, academic research especially, and innovation and new technologies. But under this program, actually for instance, KA right now is involved in a project which is financed by the FP7 project, and is about art and science. So even under other programs which are not like naturally linked to culture, there are new funding opportunities which are opening, because the Commission is trying to experiment through culture, new forms of linkages with science, with technology, with enterprise policy. One other very important policy, I think, which is very much relevant for culture, cities and regions, is cohesion policy, so the structural funds, the ERDF funding. We have recently analyzed the use of the ERDF funding, but also the European Social Fund, which is it's a huge amount of money. We have analyzed how this funding has been used by cities, regions and countries for cultural projects. And what we have found out is that 6 billion euros have been used from the period 2007 to 2013 for the sector. So if we compare to the 1.8 billion euros of Creative Europe, of course it's a huge amount of money. But of course this is not something that you have, like the cultural program, it's not cost per proposal for cost per tender that you have like at the European Commission website. It's a completely different architecture. I don't want to go into details, but just to raise awareness about the fact that right now the Commission is preparing the new cohesion policy is also the new ERDF funding for the new period. And so this money could be available for cities and regions for cultural and creative projects. It has been the case in the previous period, so until 2013, and it will probably be the case also for 2014 and 2020. And I think the opportunity with this kind of funding is that cities and regions have the possibility to include culture in a much more, in a wider discourse, which is territorial development. So it's not simply about culture, but how culture can really be integrated in a path of social and economic development at territorial level. Of good practice here, I extracted a couple. But there are very much of good examples of cities and regions who have actually used the structural funds money to regenerate their territory through culture and creativity. I here selected three. So one, as I was mentioning, is the city, it's a Nantes métropole. So it's a French city in the north of France. And it's a city which has a river, that is the Loire. And within this river, like at the center, it's basically this, we have an island, which is a former industrial island. So the city is it's a medium-sized city of nearly 600,000 inhabitants. And as many cities in Europe, it underwent a huge industrial crisis with lots of companies closing. Most of these companies were located on this island. For instance, the multinational Alstom was there. But at a certain point, basically, lots of jobs were lost and lots of companies closed. And the city was faced with several challenges. So how to create jobs, first of all, how to change the image of the city, which was seen as an industrial city, as a great city, as an industrial city. How to make this former industrial island attractive, because basically the city at a certain point found itself with full of spaces which were not used, which were completely empty, and which could be used for different purposes. So the city about 20 years ago, so it was really a long process, decided to refocus its local development policies with a focus on the tourism and cultural and creative industries. This was particularly interesting, I think, in Nantes, because it was a kind of organic process. So it was not really planned from the beginning, but step by step, the city started to welcome artists to the island, and for instance, also the itinerant theater companies. And little by little, they realized that this was working, and it was thanks to the presence of artists in this area that people were starting to come again to the island. So this, this book was saying, so the planning economy gave new life to the industrial areas and attracts new people, but also tourists and artists. So several actions have been implemented. So first of all, there were more kind of soft actions, so welcoming artists, and then more infrastructural actions. The entire island was rebuilt. And as we can see, well, this is in French, but it's a combination of different kinds of infrastructures. They created a really kind of ecosystem with almost everything in it. So with economic activities, with cultural activities, and with education infrastructure, a rich educational offer. this island is a real pretty cluster. It's called Quartier de la Création. Within this cluster, there is a creative incubator. There is the School of Fine Arts, which is moving there. And there are artistic events, which are actually hosted in what were named the former industrial building. And just to give you an idea also of the investments, about 9 million euros were spent on directly on culture, and much more actually. The overall investment was about 50 million euros to completely regenerate the area and to rebuild the area. And the results after 20 years, and I'm insisting on this because sometimes, of course, it would be great to have results like after 2 years, after 3 years, but these are a long process which require time. Now, the city of Nantes is a tourist destination, and this is especially for French people. But for French people, this has been really changed, because before this kind of interventions, Nantes was simply a city. A city you would pass through without stopping. Now people stop there. There are festivals. There are events. It's interesting for creative people who want to create their creative company thanks to them. To the infrastructure and incubators which are there, and tourists go there to visit the city, to enjoy the new atmosphere, and also thanks to this new policy that has taken place in Nantes. Now Nantes is also known at European level as a creative hub, and for instance, the city of Nantes is one of the partners also of this European Creative Industry Alliance. And they are very much working actually the spillover effects, because they want to make the most between this cultural local basis, which has been growing in the last few years, but also their industrial tradition, which is still quite strong. And also another interesting aspect is that the city of Nantes actually found the participation in different European projects as yours very interesting as a way of learning how to do things and how to regenerate the local cultures. And what I find also particularly interesting is that there is a performing arts company in the city called La Machine, and they do this huge machine, like performing arts machine, which are sometimes like fantastic animals, like elephants, and that has became really a cultural icon of the city. And it's of course very much connected also to the new branding strategy that the city has put in place. And I find this example also particularly interesting, because the people working on this kind of machines are not simply people with artistic skills, but also people having more technical skills. So I think it's a very nice example of how people with very different backgrounds can collaborate and work together. I'd also like to touch upon the city of Mons. I don't know if you know, but the city is a small, medium-sized city in the south of Belgium, located in a former industrial area. Basically, it's the area of the mines, today, of course, the mines are closed, but still, in the last 20 years, the city has tried with some difficulties to regenerate its economy, to create a new image, to attract new, not really inhabitants, but like tourists and visitors. Since in the last, I would say, 6 years, the city has tried to regenerate and to revitalize its economy and its image, thanks to a new investment in culture and creativity, especially digital creativity. And this is because, of course, it's a city which has a strong industrial tradition, but it's also a rich cultural heritage, which is little promoted. But what is even much more interesting is that this city wanted to combine the industrial tradition and cultural tradition with the new idea of cultural economy in in order to, of course, to face these challenges. So first of all, the industrialization, but also a visionalities vision of culture. It is a problem that is, I think, quite common. Of course, culture is seen as something very, very far away from people, as a luxury, as something that people cannot really enjoy unless you're rich. So one big challenge that the city has to face is to try to not only to create a new economy based on culture, but also how to convince people that culture can be a source of development, a source of growth for the city. And of course, again, the issue of image and attractiveness. So what has been done? So first of all, Mons will be European Capital of Culture in 2015. And this has been taken really as an opportunity to completely rethink the city, its infrastructure, and its activities. A couple of years ago, the city launched a new kind of cluster, digital cluster, called Digital Innovation Valley. It's an area of the city, but basically it's a branch to indicate a city where lots of digital companies are located. There is also Microsoft Innovation Center, which is funding basically the innovation actions and research actions for the companies located in this area. And there is a very much interesting companies funded by very young people. It's a fishing cactus in this area. It's a video game and serious gaming company. They are really great people, very, very dynamic. And what I find really interesting in their company is that, of course, they deal daily with creativity. But what is interesting is that they have a very multidisciplinary team. Of course, they are engineers, but they have also game developers and they have also artists. So again, an example of a company which is trying to combine different kind of knowledge and different kind of skills to come up with very distinctive innovative services and products. And they are not only working with private clients, but also they are working very much with the city in order to create new paths and new ways to enjoy the cultural heritage, to visit the cultural heritage. There is another picture from the Congress Center, because beyond the focus on the digital economy, the city also is undertaking lots of infrastructure investment in order to build a new tourism economy, and especially for business tourism. And it's basically a great Congress Center, which is a very nice piece of architecture, which is currently under construction. And the city has also started to look at Europe, not only in terms of capital of culture and the events linked to the capital of culture, but also through a recent project, recently started process, which is called the Creative Spin. It is an urban project led by the city of Birmingham. And again, it is a project about creative spillovers. So it's about what kind of methods and tools can be used to try to facilitate dialogue between the culture and creative industries, creative professional artists, and new sectors of the economy, companies, healthcare institutes, etc. So it's very much new. We are starting with this project in basically this year, and so there are unfortunately not results available yet, but it's very much about experimentation and trying to find something that is totally new and completely unexplored. And finally, and it's again about this idea of collaboration, that this is not at city level, this is at national level, but indeed I think it's interesting to show how this topic can be led also by national bodies and national ministries. It's about artistic integration in Denmark. And it's about the Kunstbrev project, which is a Danish EU-funded project. This again was funded by the European Social Fund, so one of the structural funds I was mentioning before. And it's focusing on how the ministry asked the artist, the National Artists Union, to find a solution, to find a project, to try to solve, to fight unemployment in the sector. And the artists union, together with a consultancy, they came out with this very nice project, which consists not simply of sending artists to companies, but to give